My name is Will Scott, and I work with SPEC MIX out of Nashville, Tennessee, and I would like to be the first to welcome you to the SPEC MIX BRICKLAYER 500 Carolina Regional. So we've got seven of the best masons from all over Virginia, North and South Carolina. Let's get in here and see the action, all right? Right here in stall number one is Grant Helms, and he's actually got his father, Scott Helms, helping him tender today. He's with Helms Masonry out of Mount Pleasant, North Carolina. Grant's only been laying for about 3 years, but he's already competing in his second regional competition. He's actually a second generation, like we said. His father's actually right behind him keeping that mud shook up. He's got, you know, his father's really sang his praises this year. He said the kid's just such a hard worker, and it's really good to see of that generation. And that's something we know we need to see in the industry. So it's always really, really exciting to see the next generation coming up and giving Masonry a good name. Right here in stall number two, we have Adan Valdivia and his tender Felix Hernandez. They're actually with Creative Masonry out of Greenville, Tennessee. And he's actually been laying brick for about 18 years. We talked to his boss, Fred Campbell. He said he came here with absolutely nothing, no money in his pocket, but he buckled down and learned to trade, and he truly is living the American dream now. We've seen some pictures of his house, absolutely incredible brickwork, the pizza kitchen, all the incredible things he's put out there. He really is a success story that a lot of kids can be able to look up to. So we're excited to see how he's gonna do today. Number three is Mr. Seth Brannon. He's actually from McGee Brothers, and his tender is Hector Martin. They're out of Greer, South Carolina. He's a 15-year veteran mason, and this is actually his fourth time he's been competing. He was lucky enough to fall in love with the trade through a local vocational school, a little bit different than a lot of guys that are out here. They're going to be several generations of masonry in their family. He was looking to lay around 675 brick today. He was really actually looking forward to taking his wife and kids to Vegas. I have a good feeling he's got a shot today. Here in stall number four is Mr. David Kelly. He's really no stranger to this competition. He's actually competed in five different regionals over the last 5 years. With 28 years experience, he's got a really good shot out here today. He was actually lucky enough to find a flyer at a local masonry shop 5 years ago. Saw the competition, said he had to be a part of it. He's a third generation mason, and he looks to have a really good opportunity at it today. So we went from a five-time competitor to a first-time competitor, Mr. John Bryant with Ware Masonry, and his tender, Mr. Bo Ware. They're actually out of Danville, Georgia, so they drove the farthest to be here today. John spent about 28 years laying brick, but this is actually his first competition, like we just said. John attended a local vocational school in his town, but he actually learned a lot from his father-in-law. His father-in-law immigrated from Italy, so he brought generations of masonry knowledge with him and was able to pass that down to John himself. So let's see if that actually ends up translating in today's competition. Here's stall number six, Mr. Bobby Holyfield. He was actually our very latest entry. We're excited to have him here. He's being tended by Brandon Braxton. Bobby's been laying for almost 30 years, so he's got plenty of experience. He's got four regionals under his belt. You know, he learned the trade from another trade school, a vocational school right there in his hometown. When I asked him, I said, what's the goal here? What are you really trying to lay? Bobby looked at me and said, I want to lay one more brick than second place. And that makes all the sense to me, because that's exactly what it's going to take to win. Here we go, last stall of the day, but first in our hearts, Mr. Cal Cox and his tender, Mr. Cole Cox. Here's another family duo, a father-son team. The one in stall number one, the son's land. Here, Cal's actually the father over Cole. Like we said, he's a fourth-time competitor. His father-in-law actually taught him how to lay brick. A really neat idea. He said he wanted to make sure his daughter always had food on the table, so he went ahead and taught Cal a new trade. So let's see what he's able to do. He's actually got two sons that he's passed around this knowledge to, so really cool to see that kind of information, that kind of ability to make a living being passed down generation to generation. Let's start getting into the actual bricklaying itself. We're gonna stay tight on here. What you guys are watching is Cal building what we call leads. Leads are basically placeholders or bookends at the end of this wall you're seeing. So right now it looks like he's opted for a 1, 2, 3, 4 course lead right now. Looks like he's gonna be able to get another two courses out there. So 6 courses is what he's looking at to lay right now. It's really interesting as we watch this, the different techniques. Some guys are only gonna build about a 2 or 3 course lead. That way they don't get too far ahead of himself. Looks like Cal's pretty confident he's gonna get at least 500 brick in the wall, being able to build that lead that high that fast. Here we have a very, very similar technique from Bobby. Bobby looks like he's gonna go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 leads. He's looking to lay into the 600s today. Bobby, like you said, no question. In case you can't see down there, Bobby's smiling and pointing. He knows he's gonna get over 600 brick today. Again, that's a lot of confidence. Today's brick is a little bit unique. You see, it's very, very hard looking. But once you actually get a little bit tighter on it, it's very, very porous. So what it's doing is it's sucking a lot of the moisture out of the brick. It's what we in the industry call a high IRA brick. So it's a high initial rate of absorption. So what that's doing is when he spreads that mud over top of the brick, let's tighten up on him a little bit. As he's spreading the mud across these brick, it's sucking the moisture out really, really fast. So Bobby can't get too far ahead of himself when he's spreading this mud, but it's gonna help him out in the long run because he's able to lay these leads and they're gonna be nice and strong when he pops his line on them. Move back over here to John. So John's actually gonna go a little bit shorter of a lead. We see this technique quite a bit in Vegas, the guys that don't wanna get too far ahead of themselves. For you guys at home, the rules are actually that the only brick counted is no more than 2 courses above the last completed course. So if these guys spend a whole lot of time right here on these leads and build them up too high, there's a good chance that they might not finish the wall and lose all that time and the brick that are more than 2 courses above the last completed course. A lot of times this is a little bit of a mental technique too. I know it kind of sounds funny, but sometimes these guys like to only lay a few courses up, then they'll run the gambit of the wall. And the idea of that is they can go ahead and start jamming brick into the middle of the wall. A lot of times these guys are looking around at the other walls while they're laying. It's hard not to pay attention to what your competitors are doing. When they look around like that, they'll see somebody getting way, way, way ahead of them, and it kind of gets in their head. So a lot of mental as well as physical games going on here. Tighten up on Mr. David Kelly right now. Now that we got some action going, David's actually already started spreading the wool for the backside of his first course. He's gonna go ahead and take a little bit of time right here in the beginning to make sure he's in good shape. These brick are a little bit long, so they're gonna fight him all day like that, making sure they land in the right place. Let's tighten up as we go. Really, really interesting technique. He's chose to lay on the back side of the wall first. That's the most difficult part of the wall to lay. It's not something these guys typically do on a job site, so this is a whole new animal to him. Also, if you'll watch his trowel technique, he does something a little bit unusual. A lot of the guys, they'll actually cut the mortar flush, just like he's doing right here, and they'll hit the front of the head joint. David is actually taking the mud that's left over on his trowel and he's knocking the top of the brick to give him a little bit of extra cushion.
It's an extra step, so we're gonna see if that slows him down. But again, he's making a very, very nice looking mold. We're gonna stay on him for one more minute, because as you can see, he has actually took the time to spread this entire wool. And as he has spread this entire wool, the mud is starting to harden up on him a little bit, so it's not coming off the trout quite as easily. We're gonna see if he changes techniques as we go. A very, very good looking mold so far. Mr. David Kelly. All right, I know we've mentioned it a couple of times exactly how this brick is sucking the moisture out. The guys here in the field, they call them suckers. Makes all the sense in the world. You can actually see it as he's laying, and the front half of that wall, it was already starting to set up on him a little bit. His tender's gonna have to get that mortar a little bit looser if he wants it to come off the trowel that fast. Looks like Seth's got a pretty good sized trowel in his hand. He's spreading around 3 brick for every time he drops that mud. That's a pretty good spread, especially on this dry brick. Again, here he is going ahead and laying the back side of the wall first. You can see it always feels a little bit uncoordinated as they lay like this. A lot of times you'll see that line, they've got the string line right here bouncing all over the place, because it's really, really difficult to keep the edge of that trowel from catching that. The only thing they really got to be afraid of is if the trowel catches it a little bit too hard, it could very well pop one of the line blocks at the end of the wall. Dan Valdivia, no surprise, he looks incredibly fluid. He's actually trained by Mr. Fred Campbell. That's a 3-time national bricklayer champion. So no surprise that he's got an absolutely mechanical feel to him. Speed is unreal. We've talked about it before, but a technique that Fred uses, and it looks like he passed on to Aiden, was the short leads. He's not wasting a lot of time building up the leads way too high. Typically the leads are what takes the most amount of time, so you're not getting a whole lot of brick for your buck out of that. But when these guys get to laying on these backside walls with the high leads, they're gonna be able to spend a lot more time in the middle of the wall laying quality brick. So again, we're gonna see where that which one of these techniques is gonna pan out for today. We're gonna stay a little bit tight on it. Aiden is skipping a technique called furrowing. Often these guys will lay a glob of mud down and they'll actually use their trowel to drag it across the middle of the mud, letting the mud float to a V shape. It lets the brick sit a little bit more flush when it's laid down in one motion. Obviously this is not his first time. He has incredibly smooth hands. He's able to drop that brick exactly where it needs to be without having to use the mud as a crutch. Right here in his hand. We're gonna tighten up on the tender just one second, kind of give you an idea of what he's doing. You'll see him hand stacking this brick on the board behind him. I'm gonna make sure we stay out of the way of these guys. So right now he's putting all these brick in a certain place, exactly where Grant's gonna want them. I'm sure they've communicated about this before, but that's one of the biggest parts of this entire competition, is making sure that these guys are communicating, that they know exactly what the mason's looking for, making sure his mud's in very good shape. Let's tighten back up on the wall. Impressed with Grant here. typically the leads, like we said, everybody's taking a lot of time on them. They're putting the level on it, making sure everything's square, because again, those are really the bookends for the middle of this competition. Grant is at incredible speed right now building these leads. Guarantee you that's going to pay off. The less time you have setting up these leads and the more time you have in the middle of the wall to get those quality brick in, it's going to make a big difference. Side of his lead, right where he's working. One of the judging, actually right now, let's focus on what he's doing right now. He's actually shifting these brick back out to make sure he's got a nice square lead. Very, very important. What he had going on is he had a brick here on the first course that actually floated off. It's the second course for you guys at home, but the first course we actually start counting when we count the brick. That brick had actually slid out on that loose mud, so he had to push it back in to make sure he didn't have any kind of a lip between the two bricks. Side of the wall, it's no surprise he's that much more comfortable. It does look like when he spread this wall, he got a little bit thin in some areas, so he's having to really make sure he flicks a good amount of mud in front of that brick to cover up any gaps he's got. Those gaps can really hurt him when he lays that brick down. It might tilt forward or tilt backward depending on where the lack of mud is. For you guys at home, we're about halfway through, so it's amazing how quick everybody's moving. It looks like Hector, his tender is really getting ahead of him, making sure that mud is really loose, because it doesn't look like he's having any problem with dry mud right now. Actually, no surprise, that mud is sitting right on top of a green gator backboard. Kind of hard to see under all that mud, but that's actually a poly-based board, so no moisture is being sucked out of that mortar as these guys are laying. That really makes the job easy for the tender. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, everybody at home. We are about 18 minutes in, so we still got about 41 to go. I know we're probably making him nervous sitting right on top of him, but he seems very cool, very calm, very collected. If you'll notice, on his left hand, he's wearing a glove. These brick are very, very sharp on some of these edges. And a lot of these guys, they just don't feel comfortable picking up this many brick in that short amount of time. It tears their fingers absolutely to pieces. So he's able to wear a glove on that left hand. But what we do know is that he's not super comfortable laying with a glove in his hand. It feels a little bit awkward. So he's gonna leave that one bare on his actual working hand, but able to use that, that glove to keep his fingers all right for the rest of his competition. Competition is not just the speed, it's how mechanical you can be. So we're gonna see if he's able to get as many brick in the wall using that technique. What you just watched right there is he took his trowel and he furrowed the mud. As we speak, that's exactly what he's doing. He's taking those big globs and he's spreading it out to a V to make sure that the brick's gonna sit nice and flat. Order to hit the top of the brick itself. When we came up on him, it looked like he only spread about half the wall. Obviously, he's finding out that these suckers are really eating the life out of this mortar, so he's having to spread about half the wall at a time. There's the furrowing technique we've talked quite a bit about. Not everyone does it. It does take a little bit of extra time, but a lot of times it's very, very worth it to have a brick that's going to sit and float nice and flush. Another unique thing is you'll see a lot of these guys that spread both sides of the wall, the working side and the back side of the wall. Again, knowing that this brick is taking so much moisture out of the mortar, he knows he can only get about, let's say, 20 to 22 brick at each spread before it dries up on him. Looks a little bit behind some of the other guys, but that's not really going to be the case. He's got a very, very good pace going on right now. What you're seeing is a lot of that time he spent on the leads has not allowed him the time to lay a lot of brick in the middle, unlike some of the other guys who went straight for filling in the middle of the wall. So he does look behind, but like I said, I think when this all shakes out, he's going to be very, very tight with our top two competitors right now. Stay with him because he's doing a technique I don't think I've actually ever seen in the bricklayer. The way he's laying this brick is how a lot of guys would do it on a job site. They butter the front of the brick, then they set the brick into place. In this competition, most of the guys will lay the brick first, cut the mud flush, and then use that mud that was cut to hit the head joint that's already been laid. He's actually buttering this ahead of time. So again, something you'll see quite a bit of on a job site, not real often in this competition. He took quite a bit of time to do it, but now he's almost right here in the pen, crunch time, where he's able to really start jamming some brick in the wall. But again, fluidity is going to be the most important thing. So him being nice and calm, not getting ahead of himself, not dropping brick, like we've already seen two guys today drop a brick. Anytime you got to pick a brick up twice, you've lost a brick. Stay with Cal for just a minute. Looks like he's spreading the back side of the wall first. He's already made it over halfway. Let's see if he spreads the whole thing. Nope, looks like he's only gonna spread the back side of the wall, but he did run the entire gambit of the wall. I like what he's done here. He started on the far side of the wall and he spread all the way down, but without wasting any time, he's still comfortable enough to lay this direction so he's not able to have to run to the other side of the wall. A lot of these guys are really only comfortable laying one direction, so if they lay from, let's say, east to west, they run all the way back to the west side to start over. That way they're using their dominant hand in the direction they like. Cal's obviously very experienced, even with something like this, this overhand where he might not do it very often. He's comfortable enough to lay both directions so he doesn't waste any motion. Alright, so we're about 26 minutes in, so only about 34 minutes to go now. So these guys are really pushing halfway. Again, these guys are really making it look easy, but right about now, that lower back is absolutely killing you. When you start on this wall, you have to be bent over the entire time so you can get the about, I don't know, let's say around 400 brick, you start getting high enough to get a little tension let off your back because you can stand up a little bit straighter. But right now, the quads and the lower back are absolutely killing them. Probably in the next 15 minutes, you'll see a whole lot of shaking the forearms. That's where that trowel starts getting very, very heavy. So right behind me, we have a couple of we got a couple of people here rooting for Bobby, and they're talking about his technique. It's really fun to see guys who know a lot about bricklaying. This is actually Bobby's wife behind us, and she's been watching this competition for years, loves watching him lay. So she is right on top of him, making sure he knows what's going on. You'll watch him right here. What he's actually doing is, when he pushes this brick down, he cuts that mortar flush and he flicks his trowel. That makes the mud sit real flat on the trowel, allowing a really pretty head joint. A lot of times you'll see him losing a little bit of mud. That's just because of the amount of mud he had to put on his spreading course. But that's a very, very popular technique you'll see guys use. They'll cut like that, they'll flick that trowel, and it'll sit flat, and then they'll hit the head joints. So he just changed techniques halfway through. He's gone from cutting the mortar to hitting the head joint. And every once in a while, when he's not comfortable with it, and maybe he doesn't have enough brick on the, or enough mortar on the wall, but he'll actually take the time to butter the joint before he lays the brick down. So alternating techniques, probably seeing where he's comfortable, what he's gonna, what he really wants to do for the rest of the competition. To hear from here, but you can see his tender really getting on him, letting him know it's time to start kicking some rear. He's got those leads built up. He's even got an extra brick flipped up there to help him hold some twigs, keep his line straight. As you can see, he's only spread about half the wall on the front side of the wall, so he knows he's got about 20 brick he's got to get jammed in before he has to spread any bit more mud or any more mud. Watch his hands work. This is really impressive. He has flipped every single brick. If there was a freestyle award, I guarantee it's going to John Bryan.
He's on fire!
He absolutely has a rhythm going on right now. These bricks are pretty obvious what the front and the back of the brick is. There's a lot of big, deep wire cuts on the back, so it's pretty obvious, but still, he's got a rhythm that he likes, even if he has to flip every one of those bricks. Whatever you're comfortable with, that's what makes you fast. Taking his time making sure those bricks are not lipped out. Here he is coming on this brick on this course right now. So he knows as soon as this brick's laid, he's got to start getting some mud spread on the wall. Yeah. announcer has just called halfway. We are exactly halfway right now. A lot of these guys got to feel really good about where they are. We're going to make our way back to stall number two. It looks like he's got the most brick in the wall. Again, his leads have not been very high, but he's absolutely dominating the course right now. This fast, yet that efficiently. He has spread the entire backside of the wall in about the same amount of time these guys are spreading half the wall. So really, really impressive motion. Again, he said he doesn't have youth on his side, but I think he is very, very wrong. He is absolutely moving like a young kid. Here. He's got a few sections that he didn't get quite enough mud down on the bed joint. When he sees that, after he cuts the backside of the wall, he flicks that mud down right into any of those empty spots. That's not something you see very often. Guys will try to lay to those portions of the wall that don't have enough mud, and you'll watch the brick fall right here where he's at. We're going to tighten up on where he is. Right here, as you can see, didn't get quite enough mud in that bed joint, leaving a good sized void. Now, he's got plenty of time in the tooling section to be able to go back and fill that in. But that technique right there, what that ends up doing is it forces the brick to tilt down and forward, right? That gives him the ability to lose brick on what we call a tilt brick. And he also could lose it on a lip, because when that brick rolls out, it's gonna be over the top of the edge of this one. He's only got about a quarter inch to play with. It looks like that's gonna be okay. Job. Let's move on over to stall number one. Probably right now he's got the most amount of brick in the wall right behind Mr. Valdez right here. Okay, here's where you guys are about to be really impressed. This young man, Mr. Grant, is only 19 years old. Like we said, he's only been laying around 3 years, but you can absolutely see that family experience coming into play. Got a heck of a teacher that's right behind him making sure that mud's stuck together for him. Again, you know we're making these guys nervous when we're standing right on top of them, especially laying overhand like this. I know that's something most of these guys are very uncomfortable with. It's just not something they see on their job sites. But he sure looks awfully fluid to be laying backside of the wall like that. I know he's been practicing quite a bit. We actually saw him yesterday. He helped lay out some of our junior stalls. When he got here, his fingers were already taped up. We figured he'd tape those fingers up. That way he can grab the brick. Let's say he's uncomfortable with the glove. Turns out he's been practicing so much. When he got here, he was already bleeding. That is exactly how much practice he's put in. When we say blood, sweat, and tears, apparently we really mean it on this one. Like his mud's got tight on him, so he's having to bang that brick a little bit more than he's typically used to. He's taking his time. Every once in a while you'll see his head lift up. He's looking towards the end of the wall, but he's making sure that last brick's gonna fit. A lot of times these guys get to the end, the brick's a little bit long on them. They actually have to go sometimes two, sometimes three bricks back to work them out of the way to make sure that last brick fits. So very, very good job on this course right here. Overhand, he was able to make it land. Trowel, but it looks like he's only getting about two brick out of every spread. That kind of surprises me. Oh, there we go. He's getting a little bit longer now. We're looking at three right here all the way to the end. So again, that looks like he's really starting to catch a groove.
How's
do a quick count on him. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Five completed courses. He is already over 400 brick with plenty laid up in these leads to get him close to 450. So being only a little over halfway through, I expect we're going to get awfully close to 700 brick in this roll. Cannot go too far without stopping at this wall every time. Obviously, like I said, looks like stall number one and stall number two are in a very dead heat at this moment, making hard pushes both. Looks like it's gonna be a youth versus experience type of a competition. We just talked about these brick not landing quite right. It looks like Mr. Valdez, he's taking his time. Even though he's losing some valuable bricklaying time, he's decided it's much more important to make sure that his head joints are within tolerance. He knows he's gonna be losing 25 brick for every single head joint that doesn't work out for him. As you can see, he's lifting up these lines. We can tighten up right here on where he's at right now. The only good thing about this mortar setting up on these sucker brick is that it's making this very, very solid, so he doesn't have to worry about his line pulling his lead out of square. No surprise that he's doing so well today. He actually works for McGee Brothers. That's a name everyone in the industry knows. They've actually got offices through North Carolina and South Carolina. So they're a really, really big name around town. A lot of quality bricklayers. A lot of quality bricklayers that you'll see in Vegas every year. They're the kind of people that really help the industry. They like training young guys. They really like to take the time to support these events. A lot of times we'll even have events in their yard. So really, really neat to be able to have him out here. Really hope he does well. All right, so we got about 23 minutes left. So we're gonna keep moving down these walls, see if we can find some more techniques. Catch Mr. David Kelly, he's on the back side of the wall. You can see he's taking a lot of time right now to make sure that every brick is buttered before he puts it down. Let's see if he changes that technique up again. We talked about it. There's a couple of guys out here using a couple of different techniques to make sure they're getting smooth landing bricks. As you can see right here, he's taking the time to furrow the mud, especially when it gets low. Right here, we're gonna tighten up just a little bit. Right here, yep, he had a very bald spot right there on his brick, on his bed joint. He was able to get ahead of that. Really, really hard to look ahead on your roll. You really want to be paying attention to that brick, but he saw it coming, so he was able to flick some mud down. Looks like he's going to have a problem again right here. Let's see if he has to flick a little bit of mud down or if he just lets that brick fly. Bam, no problem. Yep, went ahead and furrowed it. He wants to make sure he has a nice quality brick laid, no tipping. Probably making you seasick at home. We are doing our best to stay out of these guys' way, but still getting you some decent shots in here. Looks like John has not changed his technique at all. He knows he can only get about half this wall spread, but he knows he can really get the brick in with that good mud where he doesn't have to fight it, being able to tap every brick. So even though he's changing techniques over and over, you would think that would cost him a lot of time, but he's decided it's gonna cost him a whole lot more time if he has to tap the top of every brick to make it land flat.
If you're solid, can I get a national sponsor? 7, 8, 9, our national sponsor. 2, 4, stop doing it.
We're gonna take time to make sure we come back to John. John's actually using a Stabila Level there at the end. Absolutely incredible German crafted machine. We're so really happy to have them as a national sponsor with us. Tell you what, my favorite thing is watching a lot of these guys with their wood levels. They said they use them because their daddy used them and their granddaddy used them, and they don't want to change. But if you'll watch him when he's setting these leads to make sure everything's plumb at the end of this competition, he is able to beat that Stabila Level to absolute pieces without dinging it to pieces. It's amazing how many levels we see lately that have been warped. Really glad that Stabila's in this industry. Really glad to have him part of this competition. Bobby's finally getting to a better height. He's a tall guy, so he's gonna be bent over in this competition a lot more than the other guys. You can notice right there on his arm, every vein is popping. I can tell you something, that forearm is absolutely burnt at this moment. He's only got about 19 minutes left, but he still has a pretty good pace going. That's pretty impressive. A lot of these guys are gonna start slowing down in the last few minutes and then they give it all they got. I like that Bobby has taken the time to keep one specific pace this entire competition. Talked about out of all the guys here, not just speed, but he's very, very mechanical. Probably a Dan in number two. He's probably got the only one in this entire competition that has just as smooth of a hand.
Don't bother me a bit. Don't bother me at all. You're fine.
Sure is nice to get a little bit of encouragement from these laborers out here. Said we're not driving them too much enough. I'll tell you what, I think some of these guys actually like the camera on it. And Cal's actually picked up quite a bit of speed since we came over here. That's normally some of these guys will buckle under the pressure of people right on top of them, but it looks like Cal kind of enjoys this. Yeah, technique's fantastic. Every time he cuts and he flicks that trowel, that motor sits incredibly fat. It's not gonna have any problem at all getting on, sticking on that head joint. Catch Grant, he's working on a lead. You know, with only around, let's say 16 minutes or so left, it's impressive that he is still building leads. So he thinks in the next 16 minutes, he's not gonna have any problem getting at least 80 more brick down on the first course and another 80. So he's planning on getting 160 more brick in just the next 15 minutes. Really, really impressive. Ladies and gentlemen, the starter course that these guys built, they built it on an 8-inch block at the bottom, you can see. What that does is a lot of times that forces these guys to push each brick outside of the actual normal distance they would have. So a lot of these joints you're gonna see are gonna be bigger than 3/8. They're not gonna get dinged on this in the competition because they really needed to land flush on the block. But outside of that, on the actual wall itself, they've got to keep those things right around 3/8. Let's move to the backside. We talked very briefly about it, but voids is gonna be a big issue for a few of these guys. It looks like Grant's done a fantastic job on the backside of his wall. That's typically where we see the most voids, or what they call B-holes here in the industry. I'm gonna watch him move these lines real quick. He's gotta get them up at least one course. There he is, still looks nice and tight. He's gonna have typically a lot of these guys that will hustle to the other side, fix their line. Looks like to save some time, Grant went ahead and he moved just one side of the line, spread his way to the other side before he moves up the string. So really cool technique, a good time saver. It's not something we always see. A lot of these guys are, they're creatures of habit from a job site. They want to use the string the way they always do. But these little tips and tricks, that's what gets these guys a few extra bricks in the hole. Yep, 15 minutes, we've just got an announcement. We are in the last quarter of this competition. Okay, it looks like that may be the real problem he's gonna have on the back side of the roll. He hasn't got his leg built. He had to slide all that twig and string through the mud. So it's got a little bit nasty on him, but he seems clean enough to mason all the way around that he's gonna be able to lay through that without it bothering his trowel too much. Tighten up on this corner. What you'll see right here, we talked about voids. It's not something we typically have a big issue with, but when you see a void like this, there's not enough mud underneath that brick, so that brick is wanting to float tip on it. That could really cost him some brick by the end of the competition. Dan, he's been absolutely killing it today. Still looks like he's a little bit ahead in brick count. Looks like Adam was thinking the exact same thing Grant was. He thinks he can get at least two more courses in, another 160 brick. Again, we're only about 14 minutes left. That is a whole lot of brick these guys plan on getting on this roll right now. We talked a little bit about this twig technique of rigging up the line on one side and spreading the way down. Looks like he did not do that. Again, he may be a creature of habit. He wanted to get both sides of the string up to make sure he knew exactly where those brick rings were.
Hey, 13 minutes, let's hear it for them. Those guys are dying out there. Come on. Come on. Go. Go, go, go.
Tell you what, this technique is really helping him on a job site. These guys don't want to spread nearly as much mud on this bed joint. Actually, let's tighten up right here because again, we're to a spot where he's very thin on mud. Doesn't look like he got enough down. We're going to see if he has to go back or not. Nope, he's going to lay through it. Right now, that brick is really floating very softly. It's not going to take much for that brick to get knocked down and tilt on him. So let's see if that ends up hurting towards the end. But we'll get back to what we were saying. A lot of these guys, they don't spread nearly the amount of mud on the actual bed joints themselves. If you can tilt down, there's an unreal amount of mortar running across the backside of this wall. All that for the speed of this competition. So he has no problem throwing all the mud he possibly can on that bed joint. What that does is allow him to lay some of these brick that could be tilted, but it helps support it. So again, nothing you really see on a job site. These guys have three mortar, they don't have one problem putting a little bit too much mud, cutting and dropping it right on the floor. Stall 4 and stall 6. Those guys are probably in the running as well for craftsmen in third place. Again, when this thing is over, we really don't know. Just because you laid the most brick doesn't mean you laid the most quality brick. Yep, perfect. When we talk about quality brick, we're definitely talking about David Kelly. I mean, as far as all these walls go, he's got a few less brick in it, but he's got a really, really pretty brick. So I wouldn't be surprised when the deductions get out that he's got a very, very good shot at this thing. You can tell he's got a nice looking wall. Again, we've seen a lot of guys that have not furrowed the mud one bit. They're just trying to jam as many brick in as possible. Again, he's taking a little bit more time. It's cost him a little bit of brick, but at the end of this competition, he's got no deductions, and it's really going to help his total score. Perfect 3/8 joint on both sides. Ladies and gentlemen, that is not easy to do spreading in the middle of a wall. Let's go to Bobby. Bobby's the number 6. Bobby chose to go high lead, which we thought was going to hurt him depending on how many brick he's able to lay. Doesn't look like it has. It looks like he's able to get quite a bit of brick in this wall ever since he built those very, very tall leads. Again, we've seen Bobby use several different techniques. Watch him, he butters that brick before he sticks it in. Again, something we very rarely see in the bricklayer just because of the extra motion it takes. Ah, changed back over, now he's cutting. He's going to go ahead and butter and move. So he's pretty smooth right now. Really interesting to see.
I ain't being scared all the way through next time.
You got this. Keep pushing. You got this. One last push, buddy.
Another contender for the Craftsman Award has got to be Mr. Cal. Cal's been very, very smooth today. If he can get over that 500 brick count, I think he's got a really good shot at it because it's another beautiful wall. We talked a little bit about it. Cal, in the beginning, he was actually spreading the entire wall. Looks like he's going back to the about 20 brick or half a wall option. So he's got about, looks like 15, so a little bit less than half the wall. Let's see if he finishes the whole wall out on his bed joint. Yep, so it looks like he spread about 15 brick on the front side, went ahead and did 25 on the back side. So he's got a lot longer to go on this run. That's pretty good because we've only got about 7 minutes left. So he knows he's got to get these brick in so he doesn't waste all that time spreading.
All right. Push. On that opposite corner. Push. You got this. Come on.
That will cut this brick and they will put the head joint on. They'll put the head joint on under the line. Cal's chose to go over the line to cut his head joint. Again, it's a little bit higher of a lift with his trowel, but it looks like he feels more comfortable to not top that line too awful much going over top of it. Go back with one. As this competition winds down with only about 6 minutes to go, we're gonna bring you back to some of the higher walls so you can kind of see what's looking. You know, when we assign these stalls, we don't have any rhyme or reason. We actually draw the names out of a hat. But what are the odds number 1 and number 2 look like they're going to be number 1 and number 2 in the actual brick count? Again, quality is so incredibly important to us. It's important to the industry. It's actually what keeps our industry alive. so we really like to see the quality, but it sure is fun getting to watch this guy lay this many bricks. I mean, right now he's looking at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8. He is almost at 700 brick in this wall. Just to kind of give you guys at home an idea, a mason in a general day may not lay 700 brick in an entire 8-hour workday. This guy has just done it within an hour. The announcer has told us 5 minutes left, so it is absolutely crunch time. I'm not going to be surprised if you start hearing a lot of crowd noise behind them, especially as we're coming to the last minute. A lot of these guys, they need somebody behind them. Give them that second wind. For a 19-year-old, he looks as smooth as anyone we have seen. We've only got about 4 minutes left. Let's run over to Aidan Valdez and let's see what he's got. Right now it's crunch time, so we're gonna stay on this side of the wall. I know it's a little bit harder to see, but we gotta stay out of this guy's way. He is moving like an absolute robot. We always enjoy watching these guys spread the wall like that. They actually hold their hands. Some hold it right behind their back. Some hold it right to their chest. About a little bit about balance and a whole lot of just rhythm. They're really, really cool to see. He knows the time. He knows he's got 4 minutes. So he is still moving. I'd like to say he's sped up to get a few more brick in the wall, but I don't believe he has. It seems like this has been his pace all day long. He has actually laid enough brick that he is starting to run low on brick. His mason, or his tender, I should say, is working his rear end off, trying to keep brick ahead of him. That's really impressive. The easier job should be the tender, but it doesn't look like it is today. Hey Dan is absolutely working him to death.
Stay tight, this is pretty good. We'll go back one in just a second.
He's gonna have a little bit of thin mud right here. Let's see if he's able to get enough on the trowel to fill it out. Nope. Looks like he left the gap right there on about the 10th brick back from the end of the wall. That's gonna very easily, if he bumps that thing at any point when he spreads the next part of the wall, it can absolutely rock forward. He's looking at a possible tip brick. But we'll take a look when the judging portion comes. We'll take another look to see what happens. Again, front side of that wall is not spread all the way through. Let's see what he does. Had to squeeze a little bit tight, but it looks like it worked out for him. He's got a little bit of room to play on those tight bed joints like that. I think he's going to be just within tolerance. Look, he's got 2 minutes left. Right now, he is not wasting time jamming a bunch of bad brick in the wall. He wants to make sure everyone is going to be okay. He actually took the time to fix the brick we were just talking about that was rocking forward, didn't have quite a bit enough mud. He shook it real tight on the backside, squeezing the mud to the front, and then cut it flush. So that looked really, really good. Keep moving. We can look at number three. We can look at Seth again because he's actually been able to do what I really didn't think he could. I mean, he had a lot of room to make up. Doesn't have quite the amount of brick that the other guys do, but the amount of time he has spent running the middle of this wall, it's an amazing amount of brick in such a short amount of time. Okay. We're gonna wait just a second for him to get a little bit farther away so we can talk about it, because it's looking like he's got a brick right here that is much, much higher. I don't think it's gonna hurt him on the bed joint itself. It still looks like it's within tolerance. Where it's gonna hurt him is if he gets another force on the backside of this wall, it's going to bump that brick up, where he'll either have to run his top brick super tight or he's gonna be all completely out of whack. It's gonna hurt his plumb at the end. So
1 minute left.
He's only got about a minute left. Hopefully he does not lay back over top of that lip brick right there.
40 seconds left. 40 seconds left.
Down to the last 40 seconds, ladies and gentlemen. Hold on tight. Yep. This looks like it's a good idea. He's taking the time to take his level across it. He's beating it to death. You gotta love seeing a Stabila level that you can absolutely beat two pieces with no issues. I can't tell you how many times we see old levels snapped in half. You know, we're talking about those old plastic ones. Some of the wooden ones are a lot better, but even the wood ones, we see a lot of the glass breaking in the bubble. Really love to see Stabila out here selling levels that these guys can put to work. We only got about 10 seconds left. Let's run back to Aiden. He looks like he's got a really good shot right here. He's taking the time. Oh, looks like he found one he didn't like.
Ooh,
he's afraid he's out of time. We're actually gonna go take a look inside now. We just started a 20-minute tooling period. This is where these guys are gonna strike these walls nice and clean with some concave joints, make it as pretty as possible. What we're looking for is the most sellable wall out here. So let's get in here and see what's going on. All right, so this is Grant in stall number one. If you guys have been watching this competition at all, he's absolutely an incredible mason. At only 19 years old, he's done such a fantastic job putting, it looks like around 700 brick in this wall. As you'll see, what he's got in his hand is called a jointer, or an S-jointer. And he's actually putting that mud back in to fill those voids. Not only is he filling voids, but he's taking that jointer, he's gonna run it across the joint to make sure he gets a nice, pretty concave joint. Pay attention to right now what's happening, because what's going on is his father is actually his tender today. His father has got him a fold-out ruler, and he's using that ruler to point out anything he sees that has voids in it, right? So he's following his dad around, making sure that all those voids get filled. You're gonna see a couple of different techniques. Looks like the first thing Grant wants to do is get all those V-holes filled, all those voids filled first. Then he's gonna go back and try to strike it. We talked a little bit earlier about these walls. These brick are absolute suckers, which means this brick is very, very dry. This mortar is very, very dry. So these guys are really gonna have to work their rear ends off to make sure they get this mud struck. As you can see, the same concept is going on here. He's not using that fold-out ruler, he's actually using a tape measure, but the same concept. He's making sure he points out any kind of void he's got. You can see right now he's got quite a bit of voids here on the face of his brick where that mud got a little bit thin on the bed joint, but he's able to fill those in fairly easily with some good fresh mud he's got. Pay attention as you're watching, because a lot of these guys do it a different way. At home, we call this the Tennessee hand trowel. I guess down here it'd be the South Carolina hand trowel. A lot of times the guys will actually put the mortar on top of their regular trowel and they'll thumb it right into the joint. Looks like he's found it to be a lot easier just to throw that mud right in his glove hand and strike it as he goes. This way, come back around, and we're gonna call these guys in. Start talking from there, right? Let's go down here, just keep showing this, then we're gonna turn around. While we're right here watching this, we're actually gonna turn the camera for just a second and introduce you to one of our favorite sponsors we work with at the Bricklayer 500. Do me a favor, introduce yourself to all the people at home.
Hi everybody, Rich Morse with Stabila. I'm the Eastern Regional Manager for the United States. We've been part of these SPEC MIX events now for going on about 10 years. And what we're industry known for is our durability. As you look around the arena, you're gonna see our levels used on a daily basis in the job site. Reason being is durability. When it comes to any other manufacturer of extruded frame level, we are the most durable. We guarantee it with a lifetime warranty. We don't warp or twist. We're number one for a reason. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day.
Yeah, just like he said, it's no surprise at all. We'll pan right here. No surprise these guys got a beautiful Stabila level right here, because they knew that it was going to be the one product out here they could count on all day long. Hey, Rich, thank you so much. What's the best way to get a hold of you guys? Can we Google you, I assume, yeah?
So we're on Instagram at Stabila USA Canada, Stabila.com. Check on the website, type in your zip code to pull up a local dealer by you.
Yeah, if you're on Facebook or you're on Instagram, don't waste your time. We're going straight to Stabila, all right? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
going to tighten you right back in here. As you can see, he's already got his tape measure out. He sees the joint about 4 horses up. Yep. All right. Here's something really interesting. We laughed about a Tennessee or a South Carolina hand trowel. He's actually not even using a glove. This man absolutely has hands of a mason, right? Somebody who's worked with mortar for a long time. I'll tell you what we do know. That mortar, that Portland that's in the mortar, is very caustic, right? Can actually hurt the skin if it stays on there too long. So I think he's going to push his way through and get those hands washed off. But it looks pretty good so far. Striking seems like a fairly basic thing when you're watching online, but there are still a lot of techniques we're seeing. A lot of these guys will do all the head joints first and then go back and do bed joints. Now, what I'm referring to is the actual joint that runs down the brick. So this would be considered a bed joint. This would be considered a head joint. So a lot of these guys, they'll come through and do every one of the bed joints, then come back and hit all the heads. Some guys do the opposite. Some guys actually mix and match as they go so they don't get too far down the wall. They don't want to forget anything. Let's follow him back behind the wall. This entire competition, he's been stuck on the working side of the wall. They will not let him go to the backside. That's what makes that overhand laying so difficult. But now he's finally got a chance to get on this side of the wall. And I'm sure while he is doing this, he's taking a look at his brick, seeing how he did. Like we said, we've got a couple of guys out here that are absolutely craftsmen contenders, right? And this is definitely one of those guys. So we just talked about it. It looks like he wants to go heads first, right? See a lot of head joints. See how far down the wall he goes. He's actually taking the time to take the mud that he has spread from on top and jamming it in. It's a good technique because it's saving him a lot of time. These guys only have about 20 minutes, but it's not always a great technique because a lot of this mud sitting on top of the wall is very, very dry, right? Makes it very difficult to put that back through the joint itself. Yeah. Let's go to the next one. I'll meet you. Okay, the announcer just said they've only got about 10 minutes left. This is a 20-minute competition, so these guys really need to be trying to round the front side of their bowls. They really need to be moving quickly because, as we talked about, that mortar is very, very stiff at this moment. So these guys are really working hard to get it. Everybody's using a couple of different tools. The most common we've seen so far has been the S joiner, but we've got a couple of sled runners out here that we'll try to point out as we go. Talked a lot about the head joints being hit first. It looks like the opposite on the leads. He's taking the time to go ahead and hit every bed joint first. He's going to come back and fill it as he goes, I guarantee you. Yep. Yeah, so it looks like he definitely did the bed joints first. That may have been just out of practicality since he had a lot more voids in the head joints. Again, we talked about the head joints on the leads. These brick are being laid on top of an 8-inch block, so it's a little bit wider of a wall than they're typically used to working with, like a normal double white. So we're not really worried about the size of the joint on the ends here. And when you don't have to worry about the size of the joint, that means you're going to have a whole lot more voids in it. Looks like that poor joiner has come off on him. So he's actually having to go from the 3/8 to the 1/2-inch size, but he's doing whatever it takes to keep this thing going.
See this guy.
Looks like we got a guy already halfway through it. Bobby has no problem pushing through this. I'll tell you what, that's really a testament to the tender, making sure his mud was in good shape this entire competition. But yeah, we know how difficult that one is. Very impressive. Most of these guys, they want to run the joiner over and over and over, right? So they'll strike to get it nice and pushed in. Bobby's got enough hand strength in his hands right now that he's actually doing one hard strike and actually able to make that thing smooth out. So very impressive. Again, we talked about these masons and the hand strength and the masons and how tough their hands are. It's kind of a testament right here.
At this time, I want to get all our junior competitors on the stage and announce them.
What's up?
What's up?
And then we're going to
have some holes on the stage.
We're going to select the birds on top. We're going to get the birds in the QuikRETE 500. We're going to do a
count. We're going to tighten up on Cal now.
We're going to have 20-minute time stop. And then that will conclude.
Cal seems to be making pretty good pace as well, with only about 8 minutes left. Looks like he's going to be able to finish. Again, very, very difficult to push that mud when it gets this stiff. Also, it looks like his tender did a very good job as well, making sure that mud was fairly thinned out. Because again, we know how fast that dries up on those suckers with the brick. Okay, here's what we like to see. Like we talked about, a lot of guys might run the entire bed joint all the way across, the entire head joint all the way across. Cal's taking his time and doing a section at a time. So he might do heads first, might do beds first, but he's only going about 4 brick wide before he stops, takes his time. He wants to make sure he does not miss anything. And he's got his sump right behind him to make sure if he misses something, he's right on top of it.
Who's in stall 4? Who's in stall number 4? Who is representing stall number 4 for our junior competitor 500? Do we have a representative stall number 4? Who is operating in this stall right here? Anybody?
Bottom one don't count.
Let me see. Okay. They
don't count.
No, don't worry about it.
All right. That's right.
Dan was bent down. I thought he was done with his wall because he was hidden completely behind it, but it looks like he's still got about 3/4 of the backside of his wall. Again, with only a few minutes left, it's going to be very difficult. Here's where his real problem is going to be. He is very, very fast with that joiner, so I'm not worried about him being able to physically strike at all. Where it's going to hurt him is on the backside of this wall. You'll see quite a bit of voids running across here, so it's less about the ability to strike quickly, but he's going to have to take the time to actually put mud back into these joints. This is really important to us because the craftsmanship award is the one we really lean into. It's something that's so important in our industry to make sure that people want to continue using masonry. This really is an art. I mean, if you learn nothing else today, you can see that these guys are truly craftsmen. Just a little bit. It's kind of going to be hard to see, especially so far away, but up on the stage is our juniors. They're actually going to be competing in a 20-minute competition. It's just a scaled-down version, short in time, short in walls, but what you're getting to look at right now is the next generation of masons coming through this town, so we're really, really excited to see what they're going to be able to do. Goodness gracious, even my hands are hurting watching this.
That's Grant.
Okay, come on now. Israel. Rosara. Morgana. We got it now. The stall number 2 from Greenville, Tennessee. The creative nation.
Grant's a young man, a handsome young man. You see him adjusting his hat. He wants to make sure he looks good on the camera and good for him. Wall looks fantastic. He looks fantastic. Truth be told, he's actually a full-time model, part-time mason, but he's still pretty good at it. I'm very, very impressed.
Where? Come on now.
As you can see, his dad's taking the time to show him even things that aren't necessary, right? There's not enough voids in this wall that's gonna hurt him in the brick, but what's really important is that he wants a very good looking wall, a sellable wall, because the only thing better than taking home all the money for first place is taking home all the money for first place and Craftsman. Take a look at the back side of his wall, see if he's already got that completed or if he's got a little ways to go. Yeah, he's still got some work to do. He knew he was going to have to put a lot of effort in to get this dried mud up so fast. But it looks like he's making sure he focuses on the front side of the wall. That's the side of the wall that we're definitely going to end up taking pictures. Well, I tell you what, okay, get tight enough. Let's find out what he's got going on. What you need?
It's so hard. Can't join
him. Yeah, that's exactly right.
You know what I'm saying?
See, right now, normally we would complain that his father's not keeping some good wet mud for him to use to fill this up. This is really a tender issue, just so we know. But yeah, it is, like you said, especially when you're trying to pull the mud off the top of this. It's been sitting on this brick, just sucking every bit of moisture out of it. So really impressive. Again, the hand strength alone of being able to join this back in with your thumb, really, really impressive. Ryan! 2 minutes! 2 minutes, guys! Let's kind of tell them as we go. Hey, less than 2 minutes.
Less than 2 minutes. We're about a minute and 40 seconds.
Minute and 40 seconds. Hey, last minute and 40 seconds, so good job, guys.
They're coming down for a minute and 20 seconds.
I'll tell you what, Cal made a mistake. He should have laid a lot less brick, so he had a lot less work to do here at the end. I think that may have been the technique he was looking for. That's what I should have done.
We're coming down to our last final minute and 10 seconds.
Yep. So we missed stall number 5 that was using a sled runner. It's a much larger, longer tooling joiner. It's a great idea for real long runs. So the guys that are doing bed joints all the way across, that's exactly what they want to use. A lot of these guys, they don't use them always on their job site. So this is just something that they're very comfortable with, these small S joiners. Typically when they manufacture them, they have them not only in 3/8 of an inch, but both sides will be a different size, 3/8 to 1/2 an inch. That way, depending on the joint you have, you're able to make a nice clean concave joint. The idea behind this joining is not just to make it look pretty for us. When you build a wall like this, you want to be able to seal the mortar to the brick. That's what's going to help keep moisture out. What you're doing is making an entire wall unit, right? So instead of brick and mortar, now it is one full unit. Let's see if we can get a time.
15?
We're in the last 10 seconds. Let's see if you guys at home can count along from your computer chairs. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, let's hear it for them. Ladies and gentlemen, they are officially done. I can tell you they are absolutely dying right now, but they gotta be happy with the work we've seen out here. We've seen a lot of brick and we've seen a few brick, but on the few brick, the quality is so fantastic. I'm not surprised at all if it's really anybody's game at this point, right? So stay tuned, because we're gonna come back to bring you the award ceremony.
And we have our winner, but we're going to start with our third place. Our third place is stall number 2 from Creative Masonry, Aiden Valdivia and Felix Hernandez, with an adjusted brick count of 408 brick.
Oh, thank you, sir.
$200 cash prize. Stabila Level. And we also got a Marshalltown. Great job, guys. Came down to tip brick. Oh, that's all it was, is tip brick. Not even the beds and heads, whatever. Here, come on in. Get in the center stage. Oh, hold on, gentlemen, hold on. And let me grab you this back here. Marshalltown shirts and trowels are inside.
Yeah, like you like each other. 1, 2, 3.
Give it up for Aiden and Felix. Great job, guys. Great job. I hope to see you around, man. Good job. Good job. Good job. Okay, our second place was with an adjusted brick count of 452 brick. And boy, did we have to double check these walls many times. Our second place goes to stall number one, Grant Helms and Scott Helms. With a $350 cash prize, a Stabila Level for my fine folks at Stabila, and a Marshalltown bag full of goodies and trowels. $350 cash prize.
For you.
We gotta have the sunglasses on so it doesn't look bad in here, but I bet when I take them off.
Father, son duo here, which is great. Let's give a big round of applause to Grant and Scott Helms for a big fight there, second place. All right, this time I am going to announce our Craftsman winner with a $300 cash prize. Etched trowel from Marshalltown at Stabila Level. This award goes to anybody who lays 500 brick or more with the least amount of deductions. So even though they had deductions on the wall, it was the least that was over 500 brick. So our Craftsman winner here in South Carolina goes to stall number four, David Kelly and Nick Campbell. Come on up.
We called it. We called it. When we were walking. Yeah.
Also, you get a nice
I did too.
You went.
Nice job, guys. I know you're right.
Yeah, make sure you got a trowel in hand. There you go, make sure you put the trowel up like this. Hey, two more steps. One, two, three more steps. One, two, perfect, perfect, perfect. Ready, one, one, two, perfect. Craftsman, oh, oh, guys, that check's not gonna be good without the cash. Here's the cash, you can't cash that. Oh, don't worry about it, your picture's good. All right, there we go, sorry about that, guys. Great job. All right, let's give a big round of applause to our Craftsman winner. David and Nick, first place winner. Now we've done this first place count. We had to go back to stall number one, two, and four. Not once, not twice, but three times to find the winner. That's what we had to do. It was a close fight. We made a lot of adjustments, and we want to make sure we get the most accurate person to go out. With an adjusted brick count of 465 brick laid in 1 hour, we are going to bring back up on stage from stall number four, David Kelly and Nick Campbell. Come on up. Nick and David. Now, I know you guys have been fighting for this fight for many, many years. We're proud to see you come out to Vegas for it. Have you been to Vegas before? One time, many years ago, if I remember. Well, we welcome you back for the big fight going against Mr. Campbell here, our returning winner. With that being said, we're going to have a nice Stabila Level for you to take out to Vegas, even though they give you one out in Vegas as well. A $500 check that you cannot cash, so we'll give you a check instead. We're going to give you a cool etched trowel saying you are the first place regional winner, and you just gave me back my $500, so we're all going out tonight, everybody. Marshalltown back. And if that's not enough, you're gonna stick around a little late. I got a flat screen TV for you to bring home.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Two pictures though.
Let's give a big round of applause to our adjusted count, South Carolina Bricklayer winner, 465 brick, Mr. David Kelly and Mr. Nick Campbell.
All right.
Congratulations, guys. Congratulations. Stick around for a few minutes afterwards. I gotta meet the first place winner, Junior Bricklayer, and for all the Mason competitors,
just
came out,
like that,
thank you so much.
We've got
the
guys going straight to Vegas
thank
to compete against the best in the
world.
Cannot wait. Can't wait to see you guys there.
SPECMIX.com.